Hello everyone, how are you doing? People are joining, so we'll start in 5 minutes. Hello everyone, can you hear me? I just got a call, someone has not got the details, so I'll just send him the link. Yuganda, Swaraj, Sanyukta, Raj, Prerna, Pratik, Pradeep, Nikhil, and Tushar. Welcome you all, and you can actually start introducing meanwhile when other people join. We will start in 2-3 minutes. So on the chat itself, you can introduce yourself, just mention your occupation and your name is already there. And you can mention about, you know, what do you plan to gain from today's session. Thanks, Swara. Welcome. Definitely, we are going to give you all the cues, and in fact, the whole session, you will get to learn a lot about what is creativity and how you can use creativity for learning. As you are an HR professional, so I'm sure that the part where we are discussing about learning is going to help you. So actually, we have divided this session into different areas where we can use the creativity. So beginning with the introduction, what is creativity and how it is achieved. Then we move on to how to use creativity in different perspectives, like how to use it in learning, how to use it in designing, use in life, how to use it in marketing. So that's how our webinar is shaped. So today we are going to discuss the basics of creativity. And then we are going to also talk about how to use creativity in designing and in learning. Does that answer your question,
Swara? Thanks, Pooja. Yes, yes, it does. I'm looking forward. Thank you.
Great. Welcome. Samyukta, you are into media and want to experiment with writing. Wow. You know, we do experiments in our creative lab. We also have a creative lab for writers. So if you really want to do real experiments, you can, inquire about and join it. Vijay. Okay, so you are into civil contracting and you're a developer. Wow, that's great. Okay, I think now many people have joined, so I will just begin in 1 minute. Okay, welcome Bhumika, welcome Anil. You can start introducing yourself. Just tell us a little about yourself. What do you do and what do you wish to, expect to gain from this webinar? Welcome Raj, it's great to have you here.
Hi, Pooja, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Good afternoon. So what I feel is that I'm on a road to become more creative.
Okay, so great.
And I'm not a writer, I'm not a painter, I'm not a musician. So can a professional learn creativity? And yes. Will it help me in life?
It will definitely.
Great, thank you.
Yes, so some years back, like you could say, you know, people like Einstein, they were all famous people, creative people, but sure. They always kept the creativity secrets to themselves. But, recently in past few decades, these secrets are now out. So now people can not just understand what creativity is, not just can practice it, they can actually measure it scientifically and prove who is creative, who is not. So there, if you have heard of the multiple intelligence theory, it actually talks about creative intelligence and it gives you a very clear structure of how creativity works. So yes, now we can actually learn to be creative. I have learned to be creative. I was never creative from the beginning. I was a very average girl.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Bhumika. Okay, you have already joined here on Zoom, Bhumika. Google Meet, no, we haven't sent a Google Meet for this one. This is the right place you are in. Okay, so I'll just share my screen. So before we start, I would like to understand from you, what do you understand by creativity? You can unmute yourself and speak. Anyone, what do you understand by creativity?
I feel for me, creativity is being unique, it's being different. And doing things differently, maybe that is something that is creativity for me. I also feel to an extent, I don't know how easy it is to learn creativity, but I think it is something that we have you know, you can say inherent, or we have that in our mindset, saying, you know, we have that different spot for thinking. I feel that's creativity for me.
Yeah, actually, you are very right. The creativity is, you know, inbuilt in us. We just have to understand that it's there. It could be possible that you could be creative in one area and not another area, but that doesn't mean that you are not at all creative. Everybody is creative in his or her own way. But we need to analyze where our creativity lies.
Yeah, I feel you need to understand what's your element which makes you more creative. So if talking about myself, I am an HR professional, but I also like designing. And I feel that is one area where my creativity just overflows. It just bounces and I can do maybe designing better than my real job. So yeah, that's something.
Okay, so great. So actually you'll be happy to hear that we have a special session on designing, and there's a very, Sagar is a very good designer and I have even worked with him. He works with Scatter and he's going to take the session on designing. He's going to tell you about the fundamentals and how creativity features into designing aspects.
Amazing, amazing. Thanks, Pooja.
Yeah, you're welcome. Okay, so can you all see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, great. Okay, so now when we talk about creativity, can you tell me which is the name that first comes to your mind in the books of history, let's say? Who is the most creative person on this earth that you know about? Any names, you can type it in the chat box. Which names are you able to, recall when you talk about creativity? Anyone? Tare Zameen. Okay. Name of the person, can you say? Like a real person. So we know we are talking Steve Jobs here. Great. Yes. Amir Khan. Okay. Tesla. Great. Da Vinci. Great. Yeah, so we all know these names. And we also know that, you know, people who have been artists, who have been scientists, people who were into businesses. So we usually understand that these are the people who have over time have proved their potential, and you can see that they are creative. But can anybody tell that why do you think these people are creative? Let's say Steve Jobs or Da Vinci. Why do you say that they are creative people? You can type it in the chat box. Why do you think they are creative? Thomas Alva Edison. Great. They're passionate. So do you also have passion? They create something which was not in the world, right? Okay, now I will just take this point forward, creating something which was not in the world. So can anybody tell me about, who invented a bulb? Anybody remembers? Who invented a bulb? Edison, great. And who invented the telephone? Graham Bell, great. So you know that Edison and Graham Bell, what they invented, and for that they are actually famous. Can anybody tell me what did Einstein invent? Does anybody know what Einstein invented? He's also a scientist. He was also a scientist, right? And
relativity.
Yeah. He actually gave a theory of relativity. He did not invent anything. He discovered things. And yet, he's one of the most famous scientists and most talked about. Whenever you talk about creativity, learning, anything, his name always appears. And what he says is the secret of creativity is knowing how to hide your sources, which means whatever things are going to give you inspiration to to bring out the creativity in you. You should not tell those sources to anyone else, which is why he has always been such a mysterious person. Nobody knows what goes behind the brain of this genius, but we all know he's a genius. But now the story has changed, because now people have actually discovered the secrets of creativity. And that is exactly what we are going to discuss. That how creativity can be used in our day-to-day life, in our professional life. So in short, if we can say, from all the researches that have been done on creativity, one thing is very common, which is creativity is all about problem solving. So if there is one problem that nobody is able to solve, but you are able to solve, then you are a creative person, right? Okay, now why creativity can be a really confusing concept at present is because people take multiple approaches. You are just unable to define creativity in just one context. Creativity is everywhere. Some people say, you know, who are artists, painters, designers, they are creative. But even people working in a manufacturing unit can be creative. So there is no single way to define creativity, because it has many perspectives. So there are 7 approaches that have defined creativity in very different ways. One is mystical, which means when you connect yourself to the world, to the universe. So here I can see, you know, at least there are 3 life coaches. So you understand what is the mystical energy that we humans feel. And that is what creativity is understood from this perspective, in this mystical approach. So can anybody who is a life coach can, you know, tell us a bit about, you know, what do you feel? If we take the mystical approach to creativity, how do we define it? You can unmute yourself and speak.
The source of creativity is within us, right. As all the knowledge is within us only. Nothing is outside. It's right. Only that we try to make use in a different way. In science, they say there's a law of conservation of energy. Energy right. cannot be created or destroyed. It can be used in different way. Similarly, there's a law of conservation of knowledge also. Knowledge cannot be created or destroyed. It can be used in a different way. So creativity okay. is that using that knowledge, whatever is there, in a little different way. So that comes, and that source is within us. Everybody is creative, because that is the mystery, that the divine, the God, the creator is within us only. As a child, I think every child is creative. But right. the environment, what we provide today, that slowly they go away from creativity, because we force them, do like this, do like this, do like this. This is not the way. See, I'll tell you, you know, one boy came to me. His father brought. He, in the school, he has drawn the leaves in a different color, not in the green. The teacher scolded him, you know, why you, I see, you know that the leaves are green. And he became little, you know, disturbed into that. Then I told him, see, you take this boy out of this school. He is the most creative person. And you will be surprised after a few years that in Japan, there was one painting competition going on, international competition. He participated and won the prize there. So that is the type of education, that the type of our parents and other people. They are destroying the creativity which is within us. And then later on, we have to attend these classes to learn creativity. We are born creative. We have the think creativity.
You rightly said, Raj, that was a wonderful example. And you exactly pointed out how, you know, people can be creative and how they can be different. And like you rightly said, there is a connection that we already have with the world. So everything is actually within us. That's what the mystical creativity, you know, says. Now let's go to the next dimension, which is psychodynamic. Have you ever heard of the name Freud? Does anybody know who Freud was? You can type it in the chat box if you have heard.
Psychologist, famous.
Yeah, so he was a famous psychologist. So he actually said he had a very interesting story of how he discovered about psychology and about the secrets of psychology and learning. So he once went to give a speech on, he was very enthusiastic about something he discovered about human brain, which nobody had. So he said, you know, it's like in our brain, we have a dark room. And we also have a light. So we actually stay in light, and that is what our conscious brain is. But this dark room, we don't know what's inside this dark room. This dark room actually makes us do things, a lot of things. But sometimes we do things that we cannot justify. Why are we doing this? Because those things are triggered by the emotions that are contained in this dark room. And he gave this dark room a name of subconscious mind or unconscious mind.
Subconscious.
So that is the psychodynamic approach, which says that you have two minds inside your one brain, which is conscious mind and unconscious mind. Unconscious mind is something which you feel when you are in a state of, you know, half sleepy state, or you are in hypnotic state, or you are sleeping. That's your unconscious or subconscious mind. And the conscious mind is when we're actively seeking things and actively doing. So like right now, we all are in the conscious state. We are not unconscious. But a lot of our secrets, especially the creativity, that is actually connected with the unconscious or subconscious mind. Only when we are able to connect with our subconscious, even at the conscious level, can we actually, you know, be creative. That's what this approach says. Yeah, somebody was saying something. Okay, so now this third is the pragmatic approach, and these are very logical people. They feel, you know, everything on this earth has a purpose. So even creativity has a purpose, and creativity has a purpose of solving a problem. So for example, you can say, take a simple example of a fan. Okay, when there was no fan, there used to be times when it was very hot inside. Okay, and slowly as the, you know, this heat increased, people became uncomfortable. Somebody thought of an idea to release this pain and actually give them a way to enjoy air, even when the environment was naturally not giving it. And that's when the fan came into picture. So whoever invented fan was actually creative in the pragmatic way. So he actually solved the problems. Now we can see lots of problems. Even the Zoom is actually solving our problem of crisis today in a way. We cannot go out. We cannot learn by meeting people. So this Zoom is actually offering us a solution. It is allowing everybody to come in and have an experience even in the online space. So Zoom is actually solving your problem. And this problem solving approach is what the pragmatists believe. You must have heard of a name called Edward D. Bruno. He has a book named Lateral Thinking, in which this pragmatic approach, how to be creative logically and how to use it for problem solving, that has been described very nicely. So little high level language he uses, typical psychology language, but it's a wonderful book and you must read it. Okay, Edward, father of lateral thinking, correctly said Swara. And he has like multiple books. I have at least 4 books from Edward, and there are many more books in the market. You must explore them. Fourth is confluence approach. In this approach, now the name that I've written, it's very difficult to read. Shijen Mihaly. Now this person actually came up with a book named The Flow. This book actually talks about the principle of confluence, which says that every human being born on this earth is not alone. We are always within a culture. We are in a social institution. We have people around us. Our society affects us. Our culture affects us. So whatever we are, when we are creative, the creativity is born out of this amalgamation of what the society has to offer, what the culture has to offer, and what we have within us. So if we have lived in a specific culture, we understand that culture and we are able to actually experiment with the ideas related to that culture. So so there is a flow created, flow of energy. We are getting energy from everywhere. So have you ever heard people say that if you want to become, you know, intelligent, you should be with intelligent people. If you want to become creative, then have friends around you who are creative. Because when you have a friend who is creative, the energy automatically starts transferring in you. So you be with the person who is creative for long enough, you will become creative yourself. You will start to develop creativity. I've seen many people actually getting influenced by their friends. I too have had people who influenced me to become like that. I wasn't always the writer, but then I found people. I wasn't always the person who wanted to become a, you know, get into business, but I have people who were businessmen and they gave me the energy. Then I got the courage to, you know, just leave my job and get into the business. So this energy transfer actually happens. Okay, so here, now let us do a simple exercise. Okay, in this, what we are going to do is, we are going to do a little of social talk. I want 2 volunteers who is going to come, and I'm not giving you what we are going to do. Only after you say, yes, I'm in, I'm going to tell you what the activity is. So anybody would like to volunteer? That's difficult. What's difficult? Volunteering. Okay, then. Okay, somebody mentioned about 6 thinking hats. That's right. It's a lateral approach. Give us a topic. I will give you a cup. Come on, can't you, you know, handle an activity impromptu? It's a surprise. Okay, Anil is going to volunteer and I need 1 more person. Anil Sethi and 1 more person. Swara, would you like to volunteer? Don't worry, you don't have to give a speech. It's just an activity.
I don't mind, yeah.
Okay. Fine. So here is what you have to do. You have to basically talk to each other for 2 minutes. Okay. But here the trick is that you cannot tell the other person anything about yourself. When you're talking, you don't talk about yourself. Don't use the words like I or, you know, this happened in my life. I, me. No. You have to talk for 2 minutes, but you don't have to use your own, yourself in that. So now I am telling this, let me tell you. Now creativity comes from, you know, out of box thinking, like everybody says. Now what is out of box thinking? Is thinking beyond the flow, the convention. The convention is when you're talking to a person, any person for the first time, the first step is always to introduce yourself. Hi, I am Pooja Dubey. I do this, I do that. That's how you begin. Now, what if you want to talk to a stranger, but you don't have a freedom to introduce yourself? What are you going to speak then? Then you're going to actually rack your brain to think about something which is beyond the normal. So yes, let us do this. I will stop the sharing for a while. And let's do this for 2 minutes. Okay. Anil and Swara, you both are going to talk for 2 minutes and you are not going to use the words I, me, myself, or give any information about yourself to the person.
So it's just 1 minute, 1 minute each.
Or it has to be a conversation.
Conversation.
Okay. Hey, oh, Anil. Okay. Hi. Okay. Let me think.
Hello, Swara.
Let me, you can't use the
word
Swara.
You know, the COVID thing, Swara, is so bad, 90 days or 120 days. It has led to so much depression. And you see all around, people are committing suicides. Job losses are there. Work-life balance is getting impacted. Do you agree?
It's certainly very depressing, you know, seeing people
facing such difficult times. But something that really surprises us is, you know, how people are extending the helping hand. And it's amazing to see how people are really helping each other out, right? I mean, that's something that surprises to the most. I feel more than the COVID situation. I didn't have to do that.
So you see, Swara, what has happened is all of us, okay, are now closer to each other. We
Correct.
Are closer to the Almighty. We are closer to the Mother Nature. We have
Correct.
Started respecting animals. We have started respecting nature. And,
completely, and we get a lot of time with family also, I believe. So that that's one of the best things.
Absolutely.
We,
absolutely.
Pooja, even we is not allowed, is it?
No, you said I believe. No.
That's okay. That's okay.
And, how difficult it is to not
it
include
is
me.
Super. Super. Okay. Yeah, Anil, continue.
No. Thanks. Yeah. Is that
Anil
okay,
did
Pooja?
It really well because he's more of a coach, so he knows how to speak about
right.
Thank you.
Yeah, I enjoyed it.
Swara did very well.
Yeah. I know it's
thanks,
very
Anil.
Challenging. You know, trying not to include yourself. Just think about the other people and the world and not self. It's really difficult.
Right. Completely second you on that, Pooja.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. Good one.
Okay, so let's move a bit. Now you understand why, you know, people who are creative can be creative. Is one reason is that they can think about others, especially the designers and the, you know, UI UX people. How do you create an app which I can be very comfortable using unless you don't think about yourself? The person who's building an application, for example, is could be a genius in his own field. That person is very well versed with every technical jargon. He understands software. Dekhte, you can, you know what the software does. But the people who are going to actually use that software, they don't know anything about technology, right? We are like handicapped in technology when we are using any app for the first time. So the person who's creating an app has to think beyond himself. And he has to think about how stupid I can be when I'm using an app, right? And so if you don't know how to jump out of yourself, you will never be able to understand. Some people, I think, dropped out. Yeah, so that's one lesson of creativity that you must take home. Next time you want to think creative, think beyond yourself. Think about the world. Okay, next is cognitive thinking. So this is basically from the, you know, brain or, you know, clinical or psychological perspective. It's totally scientific. And it talks about mental representations. Like people say, people who are very famous sportsmen or, you know, very famous artists, they always say this thing. Before I achieve anything in real life, I achieve it in my mind. They visualize in their mind that, you know, for example, if you want to become a TED talker, you imagine yourself, you're standing on the stage of TED and there are 8,000 people attending your seminar and you're speaking there. You visualize it in your brain. Then your brain starts working and starts believing. And then you achieve it for real. So this visualization is nothing but a mental representation of whatever you have. So before you're going to take a do a speech or you take a session, you first rehearse that session in your head. You rehearse it in the front of a mirror or you rehearse it in your head. That's the use of cognitive capability. In that cognitive domain also, people can be creative. People who understand processes, who can visualize things very easily. They can see, see through the time and see, you know, 5 years down the line, what's going to happen if I do this? if I make this application, how are people going to use it? So this is a cognitive capability that people have, where we can be creative. Next is social personality. Now, this is something similar to the earlier one that we discussed about, you know, having the social impact. But here, it is, you know, more than just the interaction and getting creativity. It also includes our own personality. People around us, culture around us, environment around us actually shapes our personality, even our motivation. Our own personality, the motivation, the desires what we have, the dreams we have, and the culture we have. Everything put together creates a personality. So in simple words, what I can say is, how do you want people to know you? What do you think you are in front of person? So I would like any one of you to say, tell me, what do you understand how people see you? What do you think is your personality? How's your personality? Anyone? You can unmute and speak. What do you think, how people see you? What is your personality as per other people? Can you tell about it? Anyone? I know it's a bit difficult, but you can try.
It is, Pooja. In fact, I was just trying to, recollect some of the feedback that I got off lately. Yeah. And I was just trying to relate to it, if I can really, articulate it in a way wherein I understand how people perceive me. I feel people do perceive me as a smart girl, yes, and a talented person, because I have this thing of always, so I don't know why. So I told you, right, I was not expecting this invite, and I just joined because I saw that creativity thing, and right. I couldn't hold myself back. So I think that creative thing is one people know me by. So yeah, these are the three things that I can say people know me or perceive me as.
Okay, that's great. So yeah, definitely, you know, when people know you, and you also know that people know you this way, and they know you exactly the way you want them to know you, that's where the social personality creativity lies. I can take an example of, say, Salman Khan. Now, Salman Khan, do you think Salman Khan is a very good actor, very good dancer, or, you know, very good, very intelligent, or whatever you say? Do you think he's a very good actor?
Ma'am, he is good in driving only.
See, so the things that are happening off lately around, Bollywood, I don't think Salman is really a good example to quote here.
Yet, whenever he is in the movie, it's a blockbuster. Why do people go to see correct. A person who is not creative enough, who is not creative, who is not a very good actor? Why do they you want to see, and why do you want to spend so much on Salman Khan when he's not even a good actor?
I think it's all about how they are placed and promoted, I feel, in a way. In
exactly way. What I was going to say. I think
Salman has created a personality impact. It is an aura. Salman exactly. ko dekh ke log fan ban jate hain. The people don't go to see the stupid movie. They go to see Salman Khan. That's his social personality. That is the magic that he did. That is his creativity. He knows ki, you know, meko dance nahi aata, acting nahi aati, phir bhi main logo ko entertain kaise kar sakta hu. That's his creativity.
Believe me, I know, he's built himself as a brand. He's not just...
Yeah, he is a brand. Exactly. So people who are, you know, personal brands, they have that creative personality. Okay. Now, last, the psychometric, this is purely, you know, scientific domain where you can actually measure. There are many tests available. Now, these tests are very costly. While the knowledge of how to become creative is very easy to gain, but gaining a real test, you know, getting a test done on yourself is quite costly. I found out that most of these tests are like $350 or something. You give one test and you pay $350 for that. Those are like creativity related tests. Otherwise, we have been through so many psychometric tests when we were in college or when we try to get a job. They all take psychometric tests. But those are like academic or, you know, cognitive tests, you can say. Psychometric test that relates to creativity is a very difficult one. So I have studied a few tests here, and from them I have come up with some idea. This is, you know, STST. This is one kind of creativity test. So let us do a little test on ourselves, and these are the questions. So these are the questions to for you to understand if you are a creative person, and if you are, then what kind of a creative person are you? So I would like you all to pick one of the two categories. Would you like to talk about what kind of a person are you, or you would like to talk about, you know, what do you know about yourself? Okay, so what kind of a person are you? Or something about yourself. You pick any one category and write the and type the answers. Write the category and type the answers on the chat box. Any one of you can actually speak up and talk about these. As per you, what do you think? And then we decide, you know, what kind of a creativity you already have. Like we already discussed, creativity is there within you. You just have to identify. So this can be one way to do that. Okay, so one person can volunteer and speak up and tell us what is their style of creativity, and other people can type it.
So Pooja, we have to answer all the questions. See, in the first
any one category. All any the questions category. Will be too many, but you can pick up any category.
And Pooja, they just have to be a yes-no kind of a question, right? Like yes-no kind of
something
answer, right?
It's yes-no. So it's actually very you know, fast. It can be. You
straight, yeah. Play. Okay, okay.
Okay, and any one person can speak up. So we can also, you know, discuss a little more about what goes behind this yes and no answers. So who would like to go?
I'll do it.
Yeah, that'll do. Great.
Okay. Okay. I'll start from your. Are you sensitive about your environment? You want your environment?
Okay.
Yes, I'm sensitive in the sense that not only because of the lockdown, but earlier also I felt there was a lot to be done in the area of environment and greenery, and you know we were like neglecting and we were overriding the thought and the process.
Okay, so when you say you're sensitive about the environment, do you always make sure that when you go out, you always put the waste in the dustbin, and if anybody has put the waste outside, you pick it up and put it in the
I do that, and I shout, and earlier I never used to shout, I just used to ignore, because I said, how I can tell them, but now I started saying, and some people listen and they say, yeah ma'am, sorry, and some people answer me rudely. So,
right.
Yeah, so my family was telling me, please don't go and do this, because, you know, any crack person you'll meet, he'll just hit you. Because, yeah, these people are very strange and weird, you know, on the road. Everyone can't take it. So,
that's really
my husband was very scared. Yeah, he said, please don't do this.
Very like, few people are actually sensitive about environment. Even
consciously
they
are sensitive, yes.
Not.
Yeah, so one fellow literally told me, you know, that old fellow, he was quite a good, not bad, this.
Yeah, other people can continue typing while we are talking. So
he said, okay, ma'am, why don't you pick up, he's telling me. Okay. I said, you have thrown it. You shouldn't have thrown it in the first place. I don't mind picking it up. So, you know, they fall into an argument with you.
Yeah, I know. Even and I then, had a fight with one lady in the train. She was throwing everything outside, and even teaching her kid, you know, throw outside. I told her, how could you do that? I mean, if you teach your kids to throw everything outside, that's how your kids will become when they grow up, insensitive to environment. Okay, and do you often take initiative?
In any sphere, right?
Yeah, in any sphere.
Yeah, sometimes if I feel I'm up to the mark, if I'm not up to the mark, I wouldn't take an initiative.
Okay. Are you aware of your strengths?
Yes. I've been told by teachers for the last 8 to 10 years, but never believed, but I've started believing now.
Okay. Do you enjoy taking challenging tasks?
Oh, love it. I love it.
Great.
I take all different things. That's why people say, okay, one day you're doing this, the next day you're doing something different only.
Yeah, but that's what actually makes you creative, when you do something which is out of your comfort zone, which is challenging, which you think, you know, you won't be able to do it, and yet you try.
Yes. So
do you prefer working by yourself rather than in groups?
No, I love working in groups because I feel each one can learn, and we can always share the responsibilities, the benefits, and even the knowledge. So that is why I love working in groups rather than alone.
That's great. And what do you do when you are in stress? Do you do something like drawing, painting, writing, song, everything. Dance, music?
Yes, all that. I do drawing, painting, stories. I write in style, poetry. I write song, I sing, dance. I dance to any music, and music I love.
Yeah, but do you do it when you are stressed? Like to let out of, like, for example, when I am stressed, I go to piano, I start playing it, or I just write a crazy poetry, pouring out all my emotions and put it on Facebook. So that I do when I'm in stress.
Huh.
Like stress writing, stress dancing, stress poetry. Do you do that?
No. What do I do when I'm stressed? I try and first analyze the thing. And after analyzing, I somehow find the answer. Maybe right, maybe wrong. But I get one point, you know, that it doesn't have to be so disturbing to me. And then I give it up, like, okay, either by laughing or either by, as I said, dancing. So it sort of melts away the anger that's building inside, you know.
Okay, great. Thank you, Soumina, so much. And it was really, nice hearing you. And so basically, you can yourself find out that from these answers, you can say that she's a creative person. She knows about her strengths. Knowing your strength itself actually gives you a, you know, kick towards creativity. And when you work in groups, you exchange energies with people and you become creative like them. And when you're stressed, I do a lot of stress writing, stress music, stress dancing also at times. So because when you're in stress, what do people do when they're normal people, when they are stressed? They'll throw things, they'll shout, they'll scream, they will shut themselves down. But why do you have to do all these things? Creative people don't do this. When they are stressed, they start painting, they start writing, they start doing something creative. So when you are in a stress, you actually have a very pent up energy inside you. When you use this energy, and believe me, when you are in a tension, when you're actually angry, when you're in a deep stress, whatever thing you are going to pick up, that you are going to work really fast, because that will be, you will feel the adrenaline kicking inside you. And so when I'm in stress, when I'm angry, I actually start cleaning things. And then normally I am so lazy in cleaning that I feel like, you know, it will take me a whole day if I have to clean my house. But when I'm angry, I can do the same thing in just half an hour. That's because I have a lot of pent up energy that I can use. That's being creative. And some Bhumika has given answers to Sam. Okay, she has also given the answers to Sam. She said she is environmentally sensitive. And do you take initiative? Not really. So you can start doing that. And here you have already done that by answering the question. Not everybody is at 22 people. Not everybody is answering. You are answering. That means you have taken the initiative. And are you aware of your strengths? Some, not all. Okay, that's great. The strengths that you don't know about, maybe you can find out from your friends, family, or the people you interact with. And I've started learning to do that now, which is challenging. That's a great thing. And groups and working by ourselves actually depend on a type of thing in my mood. Okay, so it depends on your mood, you decide who to work with. Great. Yes, I do some of this violin stress. That's wonderful. So Bhumika, you're definitely a creative person. And Pratik has also given the first set. Sometimes accept the authority. Okay, the Pratik is actually an entrepreneur, so definitely only sometimes he will accept authority, other times he will be the authority. Second is, are you confident about your capabilities? Yes. Are you an inquisitive person who asks a lot of questions? Often, mostly. I have seen you even in previous webinars, you do ask questions, so I know you are inquisitive. And are you aware of people around you? Yes. Are you always imaginative, full of energy, such that you are never bored? Great. That's actually a very wonderful thing. You are never bored when you're creative, when you are imaginative. So, okay. So, we have got one more answer. Somebody, I go to my garden and walk. Okay, that's a great way. Now it's like we're all stuck here, but I also used to go to beach to write my stories whenever I wanted some, you know, whenever I was stressed, or I would just go on driving when I'm in stress. So yeah, so you're now here you realize that if these are the questions that are going to make you yourself realize that you are creative already, but in which area are you creative? So if you are a person who, stress kind of constructive things, if you're not doing it, start doing it. And then you will actually realize in which areas of creativity, your creativity lies. Okay. So what we are going to cover in the next session is going to be forward from here. So till now we have understood different approaches people take to define creativity, and that creativity is about problem solving, and that you have to stop thinking about yourself and think about the people, other people in the world, if you really want to be creative. And these questions can actually help you answer if you're creative or not. Now the real questionnaire is much longer, and the link is given. You can actually go and find out, but the test is very costly, so it's up to you. You can check your creativity there, but even if you answer these questions yourself, you are still halfway to understanding yourself. So if you are not a person who is using stress times to do something constructive, start doing it. And use your imagination to not get bored. At max, if you feel that you're not imaginative, watch a fantasy movie, and then you'll see you will become imaginative. Be with people who are creative, who are imaginative, and then you can become imaginative. Okay, anybody have any questions? So my session, I will stop it here. Mm-hmm. The next part I'll be covering on 15th. Okay, if you have any questions, you can ask. Otherwise, I will introduce our next speaker. Any questions?
So far, good, Pooja.
Great. So let me introduce you to our next speaker. He's Sagar. He is actually a lead designer in Scatter. So I have actually worked with him, and he has a wonderful command over all those visual aspects. So he has been working in content marketing since 2016, and currently he is working with Scatter, and he has worked in Delhi, currently in Delhi, and he has worked in Mumbai, Bangalore. He originally studied architecture, but now he's into the content space. So welcome, Sagar, and I would like you to take over from here. I will stop.
Thanks. Hi, Pooja. Thanks a lot for the introduction.
That was a great session. First of all, I'd like to start with this. That was a great session. I personally understood a lot of new things about how you can understand creativity. You know, being creative is something else. Looking at creative people is something else. But understanding how creativity works, understanding what creativity is I think I have a different and new perspective towards it. Thanks to you. It was a great session. And I love the activity where two of our members were talking to each other.
Yeah.
It was pretty difficult, yeah? It's so difficult without, you know, talking to someone without mentioning yourself.
Yeah.
So, again, okay, first of all, so what I'll do is, I think I'll have to share my screen because my webcam is not working. So I'm really sorry about
that. Yeah, you can now share the screen.
I can? Okay. Okay, can everyone see my screen?
Yes.
Yes, so I have basically, everyone should know, I have just put my own picture over here. This is me. I also illustrate. A few minutes back, we were talking about what people do when they're stressed, right? So this is pretty much what I do when I'm stressed. I make caricatures, I illustrate, I work on art. That's what I like to do. So since my webcam is not working, I thought till the time I'm not presenting anything, I'd put this here. Now, before, I think this entire session is supposed to be about creativity. So I just say a few lines about how I think creativity works. I think I'm not sure if I'm fully convinced that, you know, you can train someone to be creative. I totally believe that everyone is creative in their own way. Training someone to be creative, I'm not sure about it, because what I believe is that creativity is something that you need to discover in yourself. And, you know, it doesn't always happens in a very voluntary manner. In my own life, it has happened when, you know, things have happened in their own sequence, and you keep doing things in life and you keep realizing that, okay, these are my strengths and this is where my creativity goes. Like Pooja mentioned when she was introducing me, I studied architecture, you know, and it was never planned, just like any other kid from my school. I was also supposed to go for engineering, but I wanted to do something creative. So rather than engineering, I chose to go for architecture, because I thought, you know, architecture is something where engineering is also there and plus art is also there. So I'll probably skip the engineering part and focus more on the art side of it. And that's how it started. And then, you know, the art bit happened, the design bit happened, and currently I'm working as a graphic designer. So that's how it worked. So anyway, I think I'll start with the presentation now, and it would be great if it's as conversational as possible, because I'm not very good at speaking when people are just listening to me. So it will be great if people stop me once in a while to talk to me and discuss what I'm going to present. So can we start now? Can you all see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Okay, great. So as you can see, we'll talk about design. We'll talk about usage of different formats. I'll also try to keep it a little bit on the art side, because so what do you guys think is the difference between art and design? It's a question for everyone. You can answer it in your own way. There's no technical answer to it. There's no right or wrong answer to it. But what do you think is the difference, art and design?
Yeah, you can type in your answers on the chat box or can unmute and speak. What I feel, design is more of a, you know, visual or architectural element, and art is more of more of a free flow.
Okay. Okay.
Mm. That makes sense. Think.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah. Please go ahead.
I think art is a creativity and design we can make is the difference.
Okay. All right. So I'll tell you what, I know this is a very tricky question. And the first time someone asked me this question, I couldn't answer it, but you just wait for it. The moment I answer it, you'll say, oh yes, it makes sense. So the difference, the basic difference between art and design is art is sort of what you do for yourself. It's about loving yourself, right? When an artist is creating something, let's say it's some painting is being made by an artist. There's no guidelines. There are no thoughts. You just create whatever you like. You make it for yourself. So it's almost like loving yourself. But design, on the other hand, is like making love to someone else. Because in case of design, you have someone who will view your design, and probably there's an agenda set to it. You know, like for example, the creatives that we make for social media, for example, a brand, these brands make social media creatives and put it on Instagram, Facebook. Who are they making these things for? Not for themselves. They're making it for their customers. And that's what design is. Design is not just about, okay, isme thoda color dal dete hain, yahan pe flowers laga dete hain, isme thoda sa acha frame laga dete hain. No. Design is about whether what you have created is communicating the message to your target audience in the right way or not. That's what design is. In case of art, that's not the case. Do you guys think it makes sense?
Yes.
Yes?
Cool. Design okay, is great. Always with a view that yes, some yes. problem you are having and then you are yes. designing to solve something. Whereas the art just, many times when we have contacted the artist, they don't right. go with that tree, you know. It just comes to them and they start writing or painting or the sculpture. Where design exactly. starts with a problem, we have that thing and then we start working into that and come with a solution.
Perfect. Yes, exactly. It's like you're making a cake for yourself. That's art. But when you're making a cake for your friend, you need to know what flavors your friend would like. Yes. You need to know whether your friend would like a hot cake or a cold cake with ice cream, with chocolate syrup or what, right? Because you have someone to serve over there. That's where design works, right? So that was a short introduction to it. Now we'll talk about design, because people who have worked with designers before, who are going to work with designers in the future, who already own a business where probably design can help you grow your business, you'll need to understand how design works. And in design, we are going to talk about the usage of different formats, like you can see on the screen. So without any further delay, I'll start. There's no doubt that a visual element adds volumes to a piece of work, whether it's an advertisement, marketing collateral, article, research paper, or whatever you're creating. So especially people who run business would understand this. Visual element is important. That's why ads work. That's why people pay so much to create ads, because imagine running an ad on a radio, imagine running an ad on social media and television. It creates a difference as soon as things are visual, right? But using the wrong visual format can take away the impact of the content. And you'll see how. So right now the question is, okay, now we understood that a wrong format can probably, you know, make things worse. But then the question is, what visual format should you use and when? So let's compare two of the most popular formats. Now, when I say format, there are 100 things within design, right? There are so many. Now that social media has come up, there are GIFs, there are videos, there are Instagram stories, there's audio also. There's so many formats. But I have divided all the visual formats into two major buckets. And that's how we'll discuss things further. So these two major buckets are images and illustrations. Now, some of you, maybe most of you, would already know what illustrations are, what images are, what the difference is. For people who might not know, this is what the difference is. What you see on the left side of the screen right now is an image of an apple. What you see on the right side is an illustration of an apple. Now, both these things are the same thing. Both of these are apples. But one is image, one is an illustration. Now, imagine if you have to create a design which is probably about, let's say, apple juice. Okay. Let's say you're a food blogger. You have to upload something on social media saying that, okay, I'm going to use apple in today's lunch, whatever. So now you have the choice of either using the image of an apple or the illustration. But how do you decide what to use? That's what we're going to talk about. Again, back to the question, what visual format should you use and when? So now some of you must be thinking, obviously, yaar, image is better hota, illustrations. Images are real and images are more relatable. Kisi bhi cheez ka, toh images would be better. Some of you must be thinking, nahin, illustrations better hota hai, zyada colorful dikh sakta hai. You know, we can garnish it the way we want. But the real question is one of them actually better than the other? What do you guys think? Do you have an answer to that? Do you have a preference?
We can have a preference, but I don't think you can really decide if which one is better. I think both have different roles to play in the different kind of designs that we use, right? So
right.
I think it can be used differently at different times.
Perfect. Makes sense. Anyone feels that one is better than the other? You can say yes. There's no wrong answer to it. That's the best part about design and art. So no. Okay. So I think the same. It's like apples and oranges. You cannot really compare between the two. It's all about the situation. It's all about the context. For example, mera koi friend aata hai. Usko orange juice peena hai. But mere paas apples hai. And I personally think that apples are better than oranges. So I serve the apple juice to my friend. But then does it make sense? It does not. Because the friend is the one I'm serving right now. And he or she is actually expecting orange juice. So I'm serving the wrong thing. So it's more about the context and the situation. There's nothing better. So now that we have established that both these things have their own importance, we'll discuss situations where one works better than the other. So the first section is this one. Let's look at some situations where images are a better option than illustrations. So this is the first topic. Whenever authenticity is one of the criteria, right? Images always work better because images are more authentic. Now you think about brands which do not provide you a service, but rather a product. For example, a smartphone company, a car company, a laptop company, or any other furniture company, let's say, right? Now for these brands, you think, you just sit and think right now, if you had to actually buy a Ford car, would you ever be at all convinced if they just showed you illustrations of the car? You won't, right?
No.
Make sense? Yeah, exactly. Because that's something you want to put money in. That's something that you're going to use firsthand. You want to sit inside the car. You want to see how the car looks from inside, outside, how it looks when it goes on the road. You want to compare the size of the car with other cars. Everything has to be real. So whenever authenticity is a case, images would always work better than illustrations. So this was the first category. Again, in the same category, I have put also, sorry, I think I forgot to mention, whatever images you see, on my screen, right? These are the which have gone live, which have worked for the brands. Sorry, I think my internet went off. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Yes, now.
Sorry, yeah. I'm working on my hotspot. Someone called me, so my internet went off. Anyway, so I was saying, all the samples that you see on the screen are real live examples which have been used by the brands which I worked in the past. So this was one of the case. In the same category, you can see this, any food product, any like Anighi, maybe some cold drink, maybe some ice cream company, think about KFC, till the time they don't show you how the real product looks, you would never be convinced to go for their brand. right? So authenticity is the first case. So after every category, if you guys have any question, please stop me. I'll answer it right there and then. Okay. So second is creation speed. Now this is more important for people who actually work on the design firsthand. This is probably not for people who run a business, but people who are creators. So whenever you will work with designers, right, you'll notice that if they don't have enough time to execute a project, they would always go for an image rather than illustrations. Because in case of images, all you need to do is to find the right image. For example, the three samples that you see right now, look at the sample on the top right, where you see this old woman, she's smiling. We are talking about how home is important. Uspe kya likha hai? My home is far away across the sea, but sometimes a gentle breeze carries my mother's laughter, rekindling my tired spirit. I traveled far to know what it means. Home is where the heart is. It's so emotional, right? And the mother's face is right there. The expression is right there. So, and to create this image, to create this social media creative, it would have taken me, 15 minutes, probably 5 minutes to find the right image. And then I put the text, put the orange color over it. And then the creative is done in the best way possible. Now imagine if I had to actually illustrate this woman with the right expressions, with the detail in the hair, the teeth, everything that you see right there, it would have taken me hours. I don't know. Plus the amount of effort would have been 4 times, 5 times, 10 times maybe. But just because I could find a right image, my problem was solved in 15 minutes. So yes, creation speed is another category where images work much better than illustrations. However, finding the right stock image could be a task too. I thought mentioning this was important because, like I said, the expression of that woman, the age of the woman that I want to show, the entire feel of the image is perfect. But what if you could never find that right image? Then it would take you much more time. So that's obviously tricky. There's an exception there. But overall, creation speed ke case mein, images are better. Next category is...
I had a question on the previous slide.
Sure.
So
sure.
Can we find stock illustrations as well while creating
to
improve the speed?
Yes, you can find stock illustrations. But I'm glad you asked this question. But you know what happens is this is obviously subjective, but I have put these samples here. If you imagine the content that's written on the image, it's about home far from where you are right now. It's about your mother's laughter. It's about rekindling your tired spirit. Home is where the heart is. Sometimes to capture that emotion also, you have to use images. You can definitely try to find an illustrations on a stock website like Shutterstock. But then probably it will just be, you know, something fabricated, I would say. It won't look real. It won't capture the essence of the image. A lot of things are there. So I'm glad you asked that question. Yes, you can find illustrations.
Got it.
But then again,
so emotion, right? And the real feel of that thing matters as well. Got it.
Yes. Lots of things are there. Because again, in the end, we are working for a brand, right? So it
any
should work for them.
Any websites where we can find stock images, like, you know, good stock images?
For free. Okay. So there's this website called pexels.com. P-E-X-E-L-S. Pexels.com. They have some great... free stock images there. If you want to spend money on images, then obviously there's iStock, there's Shutterstock, there's Images Bazaar is a great website for Indian images. Lots of things are there. But I'm sure apart from Pexels also, you'll be able to find a lot of, you just need to Google free stock images and you'll find a lot of websites.
Okay.
All right. Shall we move to the next category?
Yeah.
Okay, so the next category is featured images. Now, think about those ads where Amitabh Bachchan would come on the screen and say, "Kuch bolte tha na, wo Gujarat mein aap aakar dekho aur hamare yahan ghumo phiro, aisa kuch." I don't remember the ad clearly. But the point over here is that whenever you have to show someone, show your customers that, you know, these particular set of important people that you adore and love actually knows my brand, that immediately escalates your brand authenticity, because people would be like, wow, Shahrukh Khan iske ad mein isko endorse kar raha hai, Amitabh Bachchan isko endorse kar raha hai. So you become more trustworthy as a brand. Now if you look at the sample that's there on the screen right now, these creators were made for a chain of hospitals which is based in Dubai or Saudi somewhere, I don't remember clearly. So these guys treat people who are suffering from obesity, and then they decided to create this ad for prints. Actually, this is not a digital ad, this is for prints, and they wanted to put their doctor's face over there. And now you, now that you look at it as from a customer's point of view, what you see is, you see that, okay, this post is about obesity, obviously. Then there's a doctor at the bottom, and this doctor is not a random face, because the doctor's name is also there, the hospital's name is also there, and a few other details about the doctor is also written. So this creative immediately becomes authentic to you. Now you can trust this hospital. You can trust this hospital because they are transparent enough to show you who the doctor is, who the specialist is. So whenever you have to show someone endorsing your brand, you have to feature someone, images obviously work better. Now imagine if I remove this doctor's face from this image and I just put a random illustrated cartoon of a doctor, would you ever go to this hospital? You won't. You won't take it seriously, right? So whenever you have to feature someone, you need to use images. Moving to the next category. All right. Next category is keeping it realistic. Now, imagine the example where you see, you have seen these ads, right? Mutual funds ads. जहाँ पे एक बस में दो दोस्त जा रहे होते हैं, let's say राम और श्याम. राम परेशान दिख रहा है, श्याम पीछे से आता है, बोलता है भाई क्या हुआ? राम बोलता है यार बहुत कड़की चल रही है, I don't have the money to, you know, feed my family, whatever. But Shyam rather looks happy and he tells him ki tu mutual fund mein paisa kyun nahi lagata hai. Ram bolta hai mere paas paise nahi hai mutual fund mein lagane ke liye. Shyam bolta hai koi baat nahi, mutual fund to 500 rupees se bhi shuru kar sakte hai. It's as simple as that. And then the ad ends right there. Now when you see that ad, you obviously know that these people in the ad are actors. These are not real people with real problems, but this ad has an authenticity to it because it's using real people to show the emotions, even though these are artists. So, and what happens is the videos that you see, agar aap isko socho ki ye videos actually kya hai? These videos are just a combination of images, right? Aap frame ke saath frames jodte ho. Ek frame ke saath aap 1000 aur frame jodte ho, to ek video banta hai. So these are real images of real people telling you a story, which is not real, but then still you are convinced because it looks real. So like now you look at the sample that's on the screen. Ab jaise yahan pe ye log nach rahe hain, ye jo bada wala image hai jis pe likha even sounds like home. Now I downloaded this image from Shutterstock. Now I don't know if this image was actually posed or not. I don't know if these people were actually dancing or not, but it does look real, so it serves my purpose. So that's there. Moving to the next category, any questions till now? Am I moving too fast?
No, it's fine.
No. Okay, great. This is the last section for the first category where images work better than illustrations. I think you would have understood already what I'm going to say. We are living in an era where literally everyone has a smartphone and literally everything is inside a smartphone. Whether you need to check the weather, time, you need to write a message to someone, email, click a photo, make a video, everything is happening in a phone. So, and right now we are living in an era where engineering and medical and civil services, these are not the only categories where people want to explore, where people want to go and become professionals. People are now becoming bloggers, vloggers, food vloggers, photographers, travel bloggers, architecture photographers, so many things are there, right? Now, imagine this one food blogger that you follow on Instagram. Agar wahi blogger kal se sahi asli फूड के फोटोग्राफ्स नहीं डाल के इलस्ट्रेशन डालना शुरू कर दे वुड ऑब्वियसली अनफॉलो देम बिकॉज देन इट वुड मेक सेंस सो दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कैटेगरी वेयर इमेजेस वर्क बेटर देन इलस्ट्रेशंस सो नाउ वी विल मूव टू द नेक्स्ट सेक्शन एनी क्वेश्चंस टिल नाउ Anywhere where you thought you don't agree to what I said? No.
There okay. is any Seems questions? Like... If you're okay, then just type yes. Go ahead.
Okay, cool, cool. Actually, I'm not able to see the chat box while I'm presenting it. I'm a little...
Okay, yeah, I'll read it out if anybody types anything. I'll read it out.
Okay, thanks. Thanks for So I'll move to the second and the last section of the presentation where we'll see where illustrations work better than images. The first category is fantasy. I think this, I think Pooja also mentioned something about fantasy when she was presenting earlier. So fantasy is a category where there's no limit to exploration. Like I've written on the slide, illustrations can be used to go beyond imagination, to create things that only exist inside the creator's mind. There's a reason why comic books emerged as a popular content format years ago and people are still loving them. There's a reason why fantasy movies need animation or VFX to illustrate a story that cannot exist in the real world. So now if we just limit ourselves to images, obviously it won't work because then there are so many things that we want to say, that we want to talk about, that we want to tell stories about that don't exist in the real world. And that's where illustrations play a very important role. So the sample that you see on the screen right now, this was created for Cisco. This was an internal mailer for Cisco's employees where they had to show how Cisco is better than their rival company, Brocade. So we showed Cisco as a superhero and Brocade as a villain. And that's what pretty much happens there. They both fight and Cisco wins in the end. So now you can't show employees from Cisco and Brocade fighting for real, right? So that's when you use illustrations and vectors. Moving on.
So what is yes, the end of the story? Because we cannot read it.
Okay. I think I'll also have to zoom in here. Yeah. This was created in 2016. I don't remember the story. But I can tell you that Brocade. I think 2016 or 17 this was designed. And Brocade basically comes and wo samne se lalkarta hai usko ki, you know, we can do whatever you also do and all of that. Then Cisco says, no, I can do this. Jahan pe aap dekh rahe ho, wo DNA ka illustration laga hai. Wahan pe Cisco, while he's sort of beating him up, he says, main ye bhi kar sakta hu, ye bhi kar sakta hu, tu ye nahi kar sakta hai, wagera wagera. And that's when, okay. That's how the fight begins and then story ends. All right. So... Again, I've given a small example over here. How will you ever see a cat and a mouse coexist the way Tom and Jerry did if illustrations was not possible? I think that's the best example. Second is plugins. Now, there are sometimes stories that are real, but then there are some parts of those stories which are missing. For example, the TV shows or the news channels show you these stories where something, so you know, some crime has happened, some murder has happened, and this is how it happened and all of that. And then they don't have some part of that story. They don't have evidence to it. They have some theory to plug in there. And that's when they start illustrating things. Ki ye aap illustration jo hai, ye aap TV pe dekho. Idhar se ye murderer building mein ghusa tha aur usne ye use kiya, wo use kiya, wagera wagera. Like this example, the sample you see on the screen right now. 192 tons. More than the weight of 30 African elephants. That's how much demand there was for gold in all forms by Indian consumers 2015. I'm not sure if it's a very good example because obviously you can always use real images of elephants over there. But then my point is that whenever you have to tell a story back from the history, maybe let's say mereko Akbar ke bare mein koi story batani hai. So agar main kisi actual insan ko Akbar ke kapde pehna ke aur image pe dalta hu, that would look like I'm trying to caricaturize Akbar, right? So har jagah pe images work nahi karte hain. Wahin pe agar main ek badhiya sa sketch lagata hu Akbar ka, so maybe it will look like a good interesting story to the customer, to the viewer. Yeah.
Pratik is giving an example of yesterday's flight accident was shown on news channels from illustration.
Yeah? Okay. Right. Exactly. So that's again a good thing to point out. Whenever you have to show something that's very morbid, that's very negative, that's probably gory, people usually prefer using illustrations there, because you have to convey the story no matter what, because it has happened, right? And people need to know about the story. At the same time, you cannot show something morbid, so morbid on the screen. So that's when people go for sketches, illustrations. So that was a good example.
Even now, the 9/11 and Titanic drowning, these are shown through illustrations.
So, just a 9/11 ke example, aap le lo. The people who actually recorded it live and then the news channels showed it, I mean, it was their choice to show it on the screen. But how do you feel about it when you look at it? You don't feel good about it. You feel very negative. And 9/11 पहले की बात भी है, अब बहुत सारे restrictions हैं उस चीज को लेके, अब आप हर चीज शायद नहीं दिखा सकते, आप पे केस हो सकता है. So that's when you prefer showing illustrated topics. Totally depends on what kind of channel you are, what your TG, what your target audience is. So that's subjective, totally. Moving on, data representation. I think ये सबसे common category है जहाँ पे illustrations work pretty well. If you look at your news channel where the weather guy, the girl comes and tells you कि अच्छा आज यहाँ बारिश होने वाली है, इंडिया के इस एरिया में आज धूप निकली हुई है, यहाँ पे टेम्परेचर इतना ऊपर नीचे है, और someone talking about businesses, सेंसेक्स, shares, कि अच्छा इसका शेयर इतना बढ़ गया, कम हो गया. So all the graphs and charts that you see, everything is illustrated. Obviously, there's apart from the data, there's nothing real on the screen. Everything is just illustrated. So data representation is a category. Moving on, brand mascots. Now, if you remember in the previous category, when we were discussing about how people want to keep it real, when they want to use someone's face, when they want to show that someone's endorsing them, those are called brand ambassadors. But then there are also brands who still prefer a brand mascot over a brand ambassador. But what is the reason behind it? Obviously, one reason could be finances. कि मैं अमिताभ बच्चन को नहीं hire कर सकता, मेरे पास उतने पैसे नहीं, so I'll rather go for a brand mascot. Okay, that's one thing. But another reason is that when you create a brand mascot, you obviously have the choice to create something to give that gives your brand a human face. आप actually अपने brand को alive करके एक human form में ला रहे हो. For example, the Amul girl, everyone knows about her. And Amul ko aaj tak jo bhi convey karna pada hai, wo kabhi Amul ke naam se nahi hua hai. Amul ne kabhi nahi bola hai ki Amul aisa karta hai, Amul aisa sochta hai. The Amul girl is there to convey the messages. And now that it has been so many years, Amul girl and Amul as a brand, both of them run parallelly in our mind. Jo Amul girl bol rahi hai, wohi to Amul hai. Usse hatke Amul aur kuch nahi hai. That's what Amul is. So that's how brand mascots work. They create an impression. So these creators that you see on the screen right now, this was made for a brand called Home Credit, which basically tells people, educates people about how credits and loans work. And this guy in the red kurta, his name is Arvind. And if you go on their blog and if you see all the stories, the articles, the illustrations, you'll see Arvind everywhere. Arvind is the narrator. Arvind is the guy who solves their problems. So someone who's a regular frequent reader on Home Credit, they must have started relating to Arvind by now. Ab unko kabhi bhi credit ke liye ko leke problem hoga to uske dimag mein sabse pehle Arvind aayega. Acha, Arvind ne to aisa bola tha, maine wo video dekha tha, illustrated video, ya maine wo article padha tha jisme Arvind aisa bol raha tha. So that's how brand mascots work. Now this is something which is a little technical. I don't know if everyone over here who's listening to me right now knows how illustrations can be edited, but there are different tools and software like Photoshop, Adobe Illustrator is there, where once you download an illustration from a stock website and you open it in the software within the tool, like you see on the screen right now, you can actually edit everything. Ab jaise ye character jo aapko screen pe dikh raha hai, उसका जो एक्चुअल इलस्ट्रेशन है वो लेफ्ट साइड पे दिख रहा है, where this guy is just standing in a suit, he's a businessman or someone. ऑन द राइट साइड यू कैन सी उसका पैर अलग है, हाथ अलग है, जूता अलग है. नाउ अ डिजाइनर कैन इजिली चेंज द कलर ऑफ हिज सूट, कैन चेंज द कलर ऑफ द हेयर, द शूज. वो पैर को पतला कर सकता है, मोटा कर सकता है, हाथ लंबा कर सकता है, छोटा कर सकता है. एवरीथिंग इज एडिटेबल. इन केस ऑफ इमेजेस इट्स नॉट रियली पॉसिबल, बिकॉज इन केस ऑफ इमेजेस अगर आप वो काम करोगे तो फिर वो फोटो मैनिपुलेशन बोलते हैं उसको. वो एक अलग ही कैटेगरी, वो अलग ही दुनिया है जहां पे लोग फोटो मैनिपुलेट करते हैं एंड टेक्स अ लॉट ऑफ एफर्ट. बट इलस्ट्रेशंस के केस में इट्स इजी. सो लाइक समवन आस्क्ड मी अबाउट दिस राइट व्हेन आई जस्ट स्टार्टेड द प्रेजेंटेशन, की क्या हम इलस्ट्रेशंस डाउनलोड कर सकते हैं स्टॉक वेबसाइट से. ऑब्वियसली आप कर सकते हो और उसमें आपको ये फायदा होता है कि आप एडिट कर सकते हैं. सो दैट्स वन केस. This is the last scenario where illustrations obviously work better than images. UI and UX. Everything that you see, every kind of screen that you see around you right now, whether it's a Kindle or an iPad, a smart TV, a smartphone. Hello, am I audible? Sorry, I think my network went off again.
Yeah, now audible.
Yeah, sorry. So I was saying, anything that you see on your smartphone, or your smart TV, iPad, or whatever you own, everything, the UI that you see, the icons, the numbers, the graphs, everything, it's basically illustrated. कोई एक designer तो होगा, कोई artist होगा जो बैठा होगा और उसने illustrate किया होगा. So प्लस अगेन नाउ समवन वुड से कि नई यूआई में इमेजेस भी होते हैं. ऑब्वियसली यूआई कैन बी अ कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ इमेजेस एंड इलस्ट्रेशंस, बट इट्स मेजरली मेड ऑफ इलस्ट्रेशंस, क्योंकि आप कितनी रियल इमेजेस उसमें यूज करोगे. इट ऑल्सो बिकम्स हैवी, यूआई बिकम्स हैवी एज जितना आप इमेजेस डालते हो उसमें. तो उसके लिए इलस्ट्रेशंस वर्क बेटर. सो दैट्स इट गाइस, आई एम डन विद माय प्रेजेंटेशन. एनी क्वेश्चंस, आई एम हैप्पी टू आंसर.
Yeah, thank you very much, Sagar. That was quite useful. And now I know I can think of where I should be using illustrations, where I should be using images, and I should take care of a few things. So thank you very much. Yeah. Anybody has a question, or if you don't, then we can move on to our last session, which is on learning. Anybody has question can ask him. I have also given a feedback link, so any feedback that you have, please provide us. Any
questions? Any questions, guys? Or I would think my presentation was perfect. Everyone understood everything. So that's great. Well, thanks Pratik. Glad that it's working for you.
Okay, great. So next, actually, creativity, we have learned about the basics of creativity. We also learned how creativity can be used in designing. So next, what we are going to talk about is how to use creativity in learning. But before I open my slide, I would like to understand a bit about what you understand by using creativity in learning. And do you think creativity is exactly needed in learning? And if it is, then why is it needed? You can unmute yourself and speak.
Learning as in what? Memorizing answers or in that sense?
Even today you are learning, basically. You're learning about creativity. That is also a form of learning. Any which ways.
Maybe our brain captures the most rarest of things. So that helps us to remember things.
Okay. So you're talking basically about the memory, right?
Yeah.
Memory is definitely a great part of learning. And so is application. So is what, you know, hearing, listening and everything. So yeah, like it does help you. Being creative definitely helps you. And you could have heard of systems like, you know, PEG system of memory. That is actually a creative idea to to make sure that you memorize everything. So there are people who can remember, you know, numbers up to like 20 digits at the same time. They use this PEG system of memory where numbers are connected with some images. And while your brain can very easily remember images, numbers you cannot. So when you connect these numbers with images, the memory becomes easier and you are able to remember, right? So let me show my slide now. And
so one way of like I use in learning is mind mapping, or rather note taking. So as the session is progressing, I try to take notes in a creative way rather than just writing it down. So I just pick up a topic, then mark it that how this topic is related to others, which was previously covered.
Okay. Sagar, I have made you the host. Can you give me back because I'm not able to share my screen?
Okay, sorry. How do I do it?
There is an screen. Option. You click on screen. Me and make me the click on more and make me the host. Go to my
should I click on multiple participants can share simultaneously?
Click on my name. Would that help? You will see a more button. Click that button and you will find make an option to make me the host.
Yeah, done.
Okay, great. Okay, so there are actually many myths about people have about learning. Like people think, you know, some people are just born to be good at memory, or some people are just born to understand things the best way. Some people are born musicians, born artists. So this innate intelligence, we call this, is very important for you to learn. But that is not always true. I mean, even if you are not, you know, you don't have innate intelligence, like if I talk about myself, I was not a good writer from the beginning. I have learned it. But there are writers. I know of a girl who was just 13 years old, and she was she's the daughter of one of my clients, and she is able to write like Shakespeare. So I mean, at the age of 13, that could be an innate intelligence, but that doesn't mean I cannot have that intelligence. That innate is the only thing possible. Then people also feel, you know, if you have failed in your examination, like kids all the time, there are some kids who just cannot pass their exams, who score very bad. I was also very average scorer. I was never a scholar. But that doesn't mean that, you know, you don't have creativity or you're bad. Just because you're failing in something, that doesn't mean that it's bad. Failing is actually a step to success because it helps you learn. It helps you learn about the ways you cannot fail. So I'll give you an example of this Thomas Alva Edison. He invented bulb. Everybody knows that. So he actually made 10,000 tries before he could come up with a bulb that actually glue for 2 days. And people asked him in the media, you know, how do you feel you have made, you know, 10,000 failed attempts? How does that feel? So he said, I actually feel great because by failing 10,000 times, I have learned 10,000 different ways to not make a bulb. So that's what is the importance of failing. So many people don't try because they fear failure. But you don't have to fear failure because failure actually teaches you. Yeah, it gives you bumps also in life. But then the learnings that you get from these bumps are much better than and much sounder than anything else. And people also think that, you know, if you forget, then you are a kind of loser if you don't have a good memory. But it's not necessary that everybody has a good memory. So forgetting is a natural thing. So what happens actually, everything we hear, we listen, we read, it goes into our short-term memory first, and then it gets transferred to a long-term memory. So even if your short-term memory is fantastic, if you don't make an attempt for it to go to the long-term memory, you won't learn it for a longer time. So that means everybody can forget. So forgetting is a natural thing. It's not a bad thing. You're not a loser if you don't have a good memory. It's just that you're not trying to convert your short-term memory into a long-term memory. That's the only thing. More is better. The people who learn more, who know more things, are better than you. It's not like that. There are people who have niches. You are just an expert of one thing. You may be master of only one thing and you have just dive deeper into that particular area. How is it bad? It's also good. And lastly, this is a very big confusion that I keep hearing people say that whenever I talk about, you know, writing or being creative, they say, you know, I am not a creative person. So I am a left brain person. I'm a right brain person. There's nothing like left brain or right brain. You have a full brain. You have a full box. You have this CPU ready. It's up to you whether you want to use one part of CPU more than the other part. You have a desktop. You have 100 applications there, but you don't use all the applications. Is that the fault of your desktop? It's not. Your computer is offering you 100 things, but you are not using it. So how is that the fault of your brain? It is not. You have to learn to actually. Are you able to see me? Yeah. Right. Sorry, where's the thing? Yeah. So it is, you are neither a right brain person nor a left brain person. You have a whole brain. There is no gap in your brain. You can use any part of your brain whenever you want and be a holistic thinker. Use both parts of your brain and then you can become much more creative. Any confusion in that? So otherwise I'll T model of learning. It's better to try and fail rather than not trying at all. Pratik talks about T model of learning. Yeah, wonderful. That's a very good model. It actually goes with the findings that, you know, failure can be a stepping stone to success. People say that even there are models that actually define that. So now talking about the memory. When you're listening to something, you're actually retaining only 5%. When you're reading something, you're retaining 10%. When you're watching a video, your capacity to retain is much higher. When you see an actual demo, how things work, you are able to remember even more. And when you discuss in groups, that's what we are doing in this. You know, I'm asking you to come forward and have a discussion between you, these two people. Now, we saw two people discussing in the beginning. Do you think they're ever going to forget what they discussed there? And that they have to consciously make an attempt to not include I, me, myself in their conversations. Will they ever be able to forget that experience? They won't, because they discussed. Their retention will be much more than, you know, a regular listening. Like most of the people are in the video, in the webinar, only listening. They are not discussing, which is why they are not remembering what they are learning. So it's actually the way you consume learning. 75% comes from practice. So that is why we give activities. When I gave you the activity, then your retention goes even higher. If I had not given that activity of two people, you know, trying to understand how to speak without using I, you won't remember that aspect at all. After a few days, you will forget. By teaching others is the ultimate way. You learn something and then you start teaching the same thing to others, then your learning drastically improves. Now, I want you to do one thing. You are attending this webinar. You are here to learn something. Now, based on what the screen shows you, the percentage, now calculate the percentage of retention you think you will have in the today's webinar, depending on how you contributed here. So, sabko apna apna percentage batao meko. Who is able to remember what percentage of information from this webinar? Let's see who's the best learner in today's session. So yeah, 75%. Yeah, perfect. Pratik, actually, he participated, he asked questions, he actually discussed in the group. So yes. So he also visualized how to use. 90, Nilesh. Nilesh, you're 90%. That means you're going to teach this to others, right? You are going to talk about creativity. Bhumika, 50%. Be genuine, okay? if you haven't participated in our discussions, you cannot claim yourself to be a 70, 50 or 90%. After 2 days, tell me if you are able to remember everything that's taught.
Pooja, I would like to share one thing more in this one.
Okay.
Can I?
Yeah.
See, when we were working in our research, we found that everything is getting recorded. Whatever you have seen, whatever you have learned, whatever it is there, it is perfectly recorded with the feelings also. But we are not recalling it. When any incident in your life, if you can keep on recalling, like the sad events, you know, mostly we keep on recalling, and that gives you a permanent impression. So it is the recalling which is giving you more force. If you recall your success stories quite often, because again the recording is taking place. The moment you recall, again the recording is taking place. That way you can increase that one. That was our finding when we started working
Very
into
good
that.
Point, Raj.
And then one of the scientists researched, you know, how to see how do we see a rose? So when I see a rose, it is going, my picture is getting formed and the fragrance and thing. It is not what I'm seeing now. They found out that when this signal goes, the accumulated memories about the rose come into picture. And how do you react is not based on what you are seeing, but the cumulative previous recording about this thing that come into that one. That is how our inner thing is working into that. So that we have tried to utilize it in that. So it is
rightly said. Raj, I'm really sorry to interrupt you, but this is our short session. Okay, so we will be wrapping it up in 15 minutes. So we have a lot to cover yet. So I'm really sorry for interrupting you. I think people who have discussed and who have actually participated in the activity actively can expect 75% of the learning. And if you have not participated, you have not written anything on the chat also, and still you're saying 90%, you're not being genuine. And if you're not able to figure out, you just notice yourself. Ask yourself, have I participated? Have I spoken? Have I written something? And you will know the answer. So this slide will actually help you every time analyze yourself while you're learning. And creativity is when you understand that at what point I will be able to retain the most and use that strategy for yourself. So here we go to next slide, where we are going to understand how do we identify the right learning structure or strategy for ourselves. For that, we need to know what kind of a learner are we. What type of a learner are you? What is your orientation for learning and what is your learning style? So let us talk about orientation. Now, orientation is why do you want to learn? Now, if I have to ask you, you came to this webinar and you learn, but why did you come to this webinar? Why do you want to learn about creativity, or why do you come to learn at all? So can you tell me, you can type your answers in the chat box and tell us, why do you want to learn? Anybody, you can also unmute and speak, not an issue. Why do you want to learn? Is there anything that you wish to achieve, which is why creativity is a topic that interested you? Or you just love to meet people? So you want to take part in the activities where so many people are there, or you just want to have the knowledge and maybe then deliver this knowledge to someplace other, bring new perspective to my existing knowledge. Great. So Prateek, when you are saying you are bringing a new perspective to your existing knowledge, that is your goal. So that means you have to expand upon your knowledge, and you can also be a learning oriented person who likes to capture knowledge. I am most of the time learning oriented, and many times I'm goal oriented. Sometimes I'm also activity oriented. So in this particular learning program, your orientation could be anything. It shows me interesting. Mahesh says it's interesting. So you could be an activity oriented person who would like to meet people, or you know, just want to find out what's happening around. To grow and become a better person as a professional, so that's a very specific goal, Reddy. Kunmi says, learn something new. So you are a learning oriented person. You want to gain knowledge. So now that you have asked yourself what, why are you trying to learn, you know what is your orientation. You know whether your orientation is goal or whether your orientation is learning. People who are goal oriented are, you know, at the highest level. So when I, for example, if I attend a webinar, most of the time I have a pre-planning done. Okay, if I attend this webinar, if I learn something from that, I'm going to use this for this particular activity. I'll give an example. I once went to a seminar that was on growth hacking. Before I registered for that seminar, I had a goal in mind. I am going to learn how to do that, and I'm going to experiment. I'm going to actually do an experiment. So after I have been to the webinar, I immediately bought the book from the from them, and I read that book, and I actually created a group of 12 people, actually did an experiment on growth hacking on LinkedIn. And by after that experiment, I could increase my profile views by 100%. So I had a very specific goal. So I was goal oriented for that particular webinar. Now many things go together, not one. Yeah, definitely. So at times you're oriented towards goal, at times towards activity, at times towards learning. But when you know what is your orientation, you can make the best use of it. Now let us go to a learning style. Now we know what our orientation is. What is our orientation? That makes our life a little bit easier. But here we should also understand what is my style of learning. Now I have you know, listed down a few styles. Can you read those styles and let us know what is your style of learning? Is it visual? Visual is something, you know, when you see something, you are able to immediately understand what's happening. Auditory, you listen to someone, like in this, even if I had a podcast and you just listen to the podcast, you will still retain best. That's auditory learning. Social, that means you're working in groups and only then you are able to learn. Now, you may have all different kinds of, you know, learnings actually happening from each of these, but there will be one area in which you will be strongest. And then there will be another area in which you will be little lesser, you know, and that's how you can identify what is your top skill. For me, the top skill is reading and writing. When I read books, I learn most. So reading and writing is on top. Next, when I listen, I'm able to learn a lot more. So second is auditory. Third, I'm a kinesthetic learner. When I see something, I learn it. Fourth, when I'm, you know, I see the logic. So about logic, I'll give you one example. If, you know, somebody tells me, yeah, I'll give you one, a very good example. People keep telling me, you know, you should sleep. I never used to sleep a lot. I used to sleep only for 4 hours every day. So I will stay awake for 3 a.m. and then sleep and then get up at, say, like 8 or 9. People kept telling me, my mom kept telling me, you know, you should not sleep for so short a time. Sleep for longer, but I did not listen to anyone, even when I knew that it's going to harm my health, because I'm a logical person. Then what happened? I read one book, Why We Sleep. It's by Walker, and in that book there was you know, scientific explanation given, and the research results shown that if you don't sleep, if you get sleep deprivation, there is a possibility then in 18 months you can die out of sleep deprivation. Now that was a purely logical argument that fit well in my mind. And from that day, I immediately started sleeping for 8 hours. Even if I sleep late, I get up late, but I make sure that I sleep for 8 hours every day. So because logic connected with me. Now you could also be a solitary learner. That means you want pin drop silence. My sister is a pin drop silence person. I can learn even sitting in the middle of a DJ. I can read the book and learn. But my sister, she will lock herself and she won't be able to learn anything if people are shouting in the house. So that's a solitary learning. Some people are social learners, others are solitary. So now what I want you to do is read all these. If you haven't understood, let me know. And rate. What is on top? Next. Give a rating to everything. So whatever is your, topmost quality, that this is the best way to learn, give it a rating of 1. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So you have to give ratings to 7 of these items. Some people have already started rating the first one. Reddy says reading and writing. Great, Reddy. I'm also into the reading and writing category. Urmi says logical and reading. Okay. Both. So you will actually have everything. You will be learning in every style. But which is your most prominent style is going to be your top priority. Start from there. Okay. So I will just give an example of mine. So I can begin with reading. Second is auditory. Any question, if you haven't understood anything, you can ask me. Or okay, kinesthetic, visual, reading, auditory, social, logical, solitary. So whatever is your seventh is something you can expect the least level of learning. So if you are not a solitary person, try to learn in groups. If you prefer social, then have a learning in a classroom structure and not the one-to-one. I can learn from reading, but whenever I take the self-paced courses, it becomes very difficult for me because I'm not really a solitary kind of a person. And actually when we are born, most of us are born with kinesthetic learning style. Kinesthetic, that's why, our kids actually mimic you. They see you doing things and then they learn. That's a natural style. Kinesthetic style is a very natural style, but you could be any other form of learner. So the worst part is that in our education system, kinesthetic style, despite it being the most natural style, our learning system is based on the reading and auditory system or logical at times. There is no kinesthetic learning that we ever get in our schools, which is why learning actually sucks. And people who are good at, reading or logic, they are able to get good marks, but not everybody. Even I wasn't a very person who could get good marks despite being a reader, because I had other styles too. Self-paced courses can come under visual as well. Yes, they can. But if only there is a face talking to you and there are no illustrations, there are no shows, there are no animations, then that won't be really a visual thing. That will be then more of a auditory learning. Yeah, I too do a lot of self-paced courses, and I like courses where there is a little bit of imagination, animation, stories, because there I can connect more. If you have multiple exposures, you have auditory as well as visual, you also have social, you also have reading. When you use all these, then you are a perfect learner. Then there is no way you cannot learn anything. That's how you can use your creativity and try to identify the number one style and always stick to that. Other things you can definitely use, but never forget to use. So if your education system or the people who are teaching you are not using the style that you have, you create that style for yourself. Or you change the course, you change the trainer, but you know what is your learning style. So especially for the, I think most of the people say they are kinesthetic learners. Kinesthetic learners have to participate in activities. They have to learn by doing it themselves. Otherwise you won't be able to learn. Okay, so Now I'll just give you two simple ways you can add creativity to your learning. Now when you learn in a classroom, you take notes. Do you take notes when you learn? Like it's reading and writing kind of a style. Do you take notes when you're learning? Obviously, I know everybody took notes when they were in classroom, but now while you're learning through a webinar or through a self-paced course, how many of you actually take notes? Do you make notes? Are you making notes of this webinar? Pratik?
Great. Yeah, that's great, Pratik.
So you take notes. Anybody else who takes notes from a webinar? Do you take notes?
Yes, Mr. Raj is raising his hand. I believe you can't see the screen because we're sharing it.
You can't see the screen?
No, I believe you can't see the screen. Mr. Raj is raising his hand.
Okay, yeah, I can see the chats. Reddy, he has written, I'm also. Umika, I was busy listening this one. And Mahesh, most of the time. Urmi, me. So I presume that all these people have taken notes of this webinar. Who says me most times or what? Sometimes. Okay. So yeah, when you are not taking notes, there is no harm. The only harm is that you won't remember anything. After 2 days, you will forget everything that you have learned from this webinar because you haven't taken the notes. And there is a very, sound style to take notes. Even if you're taking notes, you will still not remember a thing. Because, as most people understand, taking notes is like, just scribbling the pointers, right? Do you scribble the pointers or you take a detailed note? Most of the people do scribbling. Okay, now I have a question for you. Suppose you are in a school and you're learning from your teacher. While teacher is teaching you, you're taking notes. You've taken very extensive notes, very nice notes. Now, how many of you can say that when there is an exam, I don't need to revise anything. I don't need to, break my head to read the book. I will remember everything and I can just go in the exam and pass the exam without any revision. How many of you can say that they can do it? Can you pass the exam without studying before the exam? Provided you have taken good notes in the classroom and you have listened to your teacher very well. No, Mahesh says no. Anybody else who can pass the exam without revising notes or books or reading CBDs? No. Okay. So now most people are saying no, but this is something which I have done. Because I had a very special style of note taking. So whenever I used to sit in the class, I used to take extensive notes. My notes were not like others. And these notes, they used to get, copied by everyone. So my notes will be prepared. And while other people will be making a note of, say, 2 pages, my notes will have, say, 15 pages. Everybody will Xerox those and they will start reading it. I will never study before the exam. I used to just sleep before the exam. And when my mom used to ask me, why you're not studying? Both your sisters are studying so much. Why you're not doing it? I would say, Mom, I have studied whole year. Why do I have to study it again? I already know what I've studied. And I don't intend to become a scholar. I don't want to score 90-95%. Even if I pass, I'm happy. And I used to pass. I used to get, easily like in 70s. Most of my exams were like, I used to get 70s. That was without studying because I took notes. And why I'm telling this to you is because note taking can actually be a great learning activity and it can get imprinted in your head forever. You don't need to study again if you have taken the notes the right way. Only later in my life, I discovered that my way was actually a brilliant way to take notes. And people who are great learners actually use that note taking. So this is very simple actually. You take notes, okay? Now, after the webinar is over, after you go home, you edit your notes. That means you expand upon them. Whatever you can remember, put it down, everything. So create a detailed note of what you have learned. Then after you do that, analyze your notes.
analyze in the sense, if I read, suppose I read about creativity. Okay, creativity is about, you know, trying to understand other people and trying to take me out of the me zone. How do I do that in my life? Could I have done in my life earlier? Can I do it in a particular situation? What are the examples? All these things you think and write it down. Then you reflect upon your experience and learning. What did you exactly learn? How much percentage did you learn? Are you able to use it in your life? How has your experience been till now? And what would have happened if you had used the learning you got today in your experiences earlier? This is called reflection. Now, in universities abroad, you have reflective essays written by students. But in India, it doesn't happen. So, you know, we don't learn creatively. This is a creative way of note-taking. Okay, Pratik has written a few notes. I take quick notes and then structure the notes immediately, post any session into segments like key takeaways, to-do, connect with any book resource. That's a wonderful thing, Pratik. And that's exactly how you can actually learn by taking notes. So people who are not taking notes can take note of taking notes. And from next time, you can actually take notes. Okay. So yeah, and this is last, and it's again a very useful creative way of learning. Now, when you learn anything, you do practice, right? Like when you were a kid, you learned ABCD and you practiced it. Then have you ever found people, you know, in your classmates that you took so much time to learn something by practice? You have practiced for so long, but your classmate, he's able to do it so fast. He is able to learn the thing by practicing it only two or three times, but you took 10 times to practice and still you're not able to learn. Has that ever happened to you? Pratik, you were a first bencher. Mostly. You and I was a first bencher. So can anybody tell me, has it ever happened? You can even speak and unmute yourself, that, you know, you felt that other people are able to learn faster with least practice, but you are not able to learn that fast despite practicing a lot. Has it ever happened in any case? With me, it happens in music and designing. Has it ever happened? Probably due to my height. Okay, so anybody who can say that, you know, you feel that you are a slow learner. Who feels that you are a slow learner? I used to feel the same way, that I'm a slow learner. Only later I realized it is not true, and I'll tell you why it is not true. Anybody who thinks?
I think I'm a slow learner only when I don't want to learn something. When someone's forcing me to, you know, listen to something and say, "Arey, ye tumhare liye achha hai, isko seekh lo, learn it." But then I know that I don't want to learn it. In that case, I'm probably a slow learner.
Yeah, exactly. So you're not exactly a slow learner, nor am I, nor anybody is. It is up to you. You want to learn, you will learn. If you don't want to learn, then you're automatically slow. So you are not exactly a slow learner. Your speed of learning depends on your interest in the way you learn. So this is what we call a deliberate practice. This is used by people like, you know, Sachin Tendulkar and those, you know, geniuses who learn things really fast, and they can. So people who are ultra learners. Now, ultra learners are the people who can learn everything in a very short span of time. Now, how do we do that? First, we need to commit ourselves to learning, which is where the interest comes. Like Sagar rightly said, if somebody tells me to learn, I am not committed. But if I decide to learn, I am committed. When I'm committed, I will definitely learn. If somebody else is saying, I will not learn. That's where commitment comes into picture. Then once you have decided, okay, fine. I have decided that I want to learn designing, let's say. Now designing has multiple components. You know, you have to learn drawing, you have to learn the, like, how to understand color harmony, you have to learn software to use, then you have to learn maybe how to edit the pictures. So these are like too many areas that you have to cover to become an expert designer. I will divide these into these components, and maybe I'm already good at drawing. So now these things, I am strong in certain points, I'm weak in other points. Now, as far as designing is concerned, I may be good in technology, but I'm pathetic in drawing. So do I have to really work on technology front, which I know I'm already good at? No, you have to work on your weak areas. Strong areas to strong hai na, dobara, why do you have to work? You don't have to. So I will work only on the, you know, those creative aspects, you know, drawing and color harmony, because those are my weak areas. So I will only focus on my weak areas. I will not focus on learning technology. I know I'm already fast at that. So first you identify components, identify strong, weak, work on the weak components. And once and on, and you know, try your best with full capacity to improve upon your weak components. Then you give positive, when you're learning, give positive feedback to yourself. I have done very well today. World can tell you, you know, you are pathetic in designing, but if you want to become better, you say, okay, I have done this better than before. I have done good. You have to motivate yourself. And other people are very good at giving you negative feedback. So take the negative feedback. Do not be offended if people are saying you are bad, but try to analyze their answers. Why are they thinking that you're bad? Ask them straight away question. Why do you think I'm bad at that? What exactly did I go, where exactly did I go wrong? And when they give you feedback, do not take it to your heart, but take it analytically and understand it. I know it's difficult even for me. At first, you get offended. How dare this person say I'm bad? I feel I'm good. How can this person say I'm bad? But, you know, try to take the hints from it. Even if you are, you know, blasting at the person, at later on, you can think about it and you can actually draw some lessons from the feedback. Finally, when you have analyzed their feedback, you have dig deeper, then you will understand, okay, he said, I am bad at that. And if you know that the area where he identified your weakness is actually your weak component, then you are not at fault at all, because you already know you are weak at it. So you need to just work on it. So you have to commit yourself to learning, divide your learning into some smaller components, divide strong and weak components, work on your weaknesses, give yourself positive feedback, take negative feedback from others and analyze the feedback to find out the areas that are missing. This practice, this is how you practice. This is called a deliberate practice. This is not a regular practice. Regular practice matlab karte jao, karte jao, karte jao, karte jao. Regular practice mein kya hota hai? Aap 100 saal tak you are doing the same thing. That doesn't give you promotion. That doesn't make you best. It's only the deliberate practice that makes you best. Like if we take an example of Sachin Tendulkar, everybody knows him. He has practiced like any other person, but what is the difference between his practice and others? Now, I'm not a very big sports fan, but can anybody tell me what is the difference in the way he practices and any other sports person practices? Why is he the best? Can anybody tell? You can unmute yourself and speak. And don't worry, I'm not going to bore you for longer. This is our last slide and you can tell me. And then if you have any questions, you can ask. Yeah, anybody would like to speak about
Sachin
Tendulkar? Yeah.
I think, I don't know. I'm also not a very sports person, sort of. But I think it's also Sachin's humility that people are a fan of. He's not just a great cricketer, but it's he's also humble. And it's visible in the way he plays, the way he behaves. So I think that works for me.
Okay. So anything about, you know, the technical side of, you know, his style of practicing? Anybody who follows sports can actually tell what is behind his story. Because I'm not a sports follower. But I know. I have read about him and about other people who do deliberate practice. And he's one of them. So that will help you.
Hi.
Yeah.
I think it's the first time I'm talking. This is Aziz.
Yes,
I come from Royal Enfield. I lead and manage the administration for the company. As far as Sachin Tendulkar is concerned, you know, there's also a small little story. And I'll not bore you. But there were these two really good boys who were like really excellent cricketers. Sachin Tendulkar, which was a very orthodox, low-life sort of a boy. And there was a dynamic cricketer because of whom actually Sachin really got into the mainframe. And that was Vinod Kambli. And today, as we speak, we know where Sachin Tendulkar is and where Vinod Kambli is. The thing that Vinod Kambli used to hit maximum six, used to make more runs than Sachin Tendulkar. And he was always BCCI's first choice. What Sachin used to do, A, and I think that from sportsman perspective, this is a great learning. And even in our own corporate lives, I believe this is a very important lesson for all of us, that he was a stickler to excellence. He believed in recognized excellence. There were a lot of things that he knew that he was not good at. So there was a time where these boys had to, and I'm telling you this because before joining the administration or the corporate world, I used to work for hotels, and I used to work for the Taj Mahal Hotel, Bombay, once upon a time. And where all these international cricket teams would come and stay during the World Cup times, etc. And I still remember, the cricket team coach would call all the boys at 6 o'clock, take two fruits and go straight away to Wankhede Stadium for practice. And I remember Yuvraj, Saurav Ganguly, and Harbhajan Singh running at 6:15 and coming down, grabbing a fruit and getting into the bus. And Sachin actually used to come at around 5:30 in the morning. Used to have a 10-minute chat with the coach. If you guys remember, Greg Chappell used to be there at that time. And probably used to ask him what he could do. Behind the swimming pool of the Taj, he would just go and he would just spend some time on the treadmill. He will try some, batting actions. He would also try some bowling actions. And he would be the first guy to enter the bus and sit while all these other senior so-called players would take a lot of time. So what the learning from here really is that if you've got to do something and you've got to do it well, you need to keep trying. And discipline is something which is very, very critical. And, today, most of us are working from home even today while we are having this webinar. But I think, we should not let go of the discipline. If you were waking up at 5 in the morning, we should wake up at 5 o'clock. And we should probably go out for a small walk or whatever it takes. Because working from home is not going to really end. And I tell my team of administrators who report into me, and I tell them that, you're so many of you. And your job was to make sure that all 3,000 employees in India are looked after well and stay productive and effective when they come to work. Today, they are not. They are working from home. So there are two options we have. Either you find yourself another option, a job opportunity, or I am challenging you to come back to me, find ways, how can we make sure that our stakeholders who are working from home, our contemporaries, juniors, seniors, whoever's at home, if you were offering him stationery, if you were, getting them some support, Wi-Fi, etc., how can you really do make a difference and make sure that the stakeholders stay productive? So I'm happy to report that a small little idea one of my team members came up with, and we actually implemented it. It's working out. So we told our employees that we understand that you are working from home. Most of you are either working from a sofa or from your dining chair, and we understand it does not give you a proper lumbar support. So please feel free. Let us know if you'd like your own ergonomic chair from your workstation. We'll have it sent to your home. So I'm happy that at least they thought about something, what they could do. And there are many other options. So obviously at the corporate office or any other larger facility, we are not spending on employee welfare anymore. I don't think there'll be any Diwali party, there'll be any Christmas party. So I said, can we use that employee welfare? Maybe talk to Netflix and see if we can tie up with Netflix and offer a special plan to our employees. Can we, you know, look at talking to a Zomato or Swiggy and say, hey, you know, once in a week or maybe once in, I mean, 3-4 times in a month, give some promo code so that our employees can use your service and get some additional discount. So I'm actually challenging them to come up with things that, because at least we know, I mean, I hope I'm wrong, but at least for the next 1 year, I don't see people coming back to work. And if I have to manage a pan-India workforce of an administration and facilities team, I better challenge them so that they come up with some solutions. So yeah, deliberate practice is very important, and trying to, you know, find little innovation in whatever you're doing, because if we don't, so I told them that, you know, think about this 5 years or 3 years from now, what do you see offices adapting? So it could be a facial recognition, you know, your ID cards will change, or so many things. Try and come up with those ideas. Let's try and see if we can invest on those technologies and be the front runners, because eventually everybody has to.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's my take. And most importantly, I tell them that it's all right to get brickbats or, you know, negative feedback, but you know, even if you think you've done a wonderful job, there is always a scope of improvement.
Yes, there is.
So don't think that I've hit a century, so I'm the best player. No, you are as good as your last job. And I think that's applicable to all of us.
Yes.
Globally. Thank you.
Yeah, that was a wonderful example, Aziz. And you rightly pointed out a deliberate practice is about, you know, keeping, being on toes and always keep improving. And like you have yourself told the story of Sachin Tendulkar, how he practices, which I didn't know. And thank you for that. But yeah, that's how, you know, deliberate practice actually works. It's a creative way of doing the creative way. Like I initially said, it's all about solving problems. So here we have solved the problem of learning two ways, you know, when, organized way of note taking and deliberate practice. There's nothing that you cannot learn. Okay, so now with this note, I would like to, you know, ask if you have any questions, and I would also like a little feedback on how did you find this session. And anybody can speak up, and I would just not want to understand. You can also give me negative feedback so I can improve this webinar and my deliveries. So yeah, please unmute yourself and tell me.
I think I was the last guy to speak up. So
yeah.
The entire panel, the honorable, contemporaries who are listening and also contributing in making sure this, webinar is so interesting, especially Rajji or Sagar, you know, or Prateek, you know, there was one lady also who was talking and giving a lot of news. It was quite a insightful session. And I'm happy that, you know, in India, at least we are all slowly and surely trying to adapt ourselves, no matter what age group we are in, to this technology, whether it is Zoom or Microsoft Meets or, the Google Meet ecosystem. What I'm really, really excited is that there are certain really good examples that were shared in this 2 hours, and I think I have finally taken some notes, which I will make sure that I will use it to make myself more relevant. Thank you so much, everyone. And I, of course, I'm waiting to hear other members' views as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Aziz, I would like to congratulate you that working from home, you know, the HR people are thinking that creative ideas, how the life can be made really more productive and more enjoyable and things. That's a big challenge. And I'm very happy that the HRD people have started thinking, and I congratulate you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Yeah, anybody would like to add, how was the session? How did you feel, or did you learn, or any questions that you have, you can ask. Yeah, so I'll be I have given you a feedback link. You can give your detailed feedback on the link. And you can also, you know, mention your feedback directly on wherever you found this post, like on LinkedIn. I have posted about this webinar. You can just give your feedback there also. Smaller feedback, if you are not a fan of writing a big feedback, you can give a smaller feedback on LinkedIn. A comment would do. Or anybody would like to speak up and, you know, let me know. You can actually tell me any negative points that we had in this session. So that will help me improve.
Pooja, it was a very wonderful session. The way you conducted and the things, you know, even the illustration and the images that he gave an insight into that, you know, where to use the thing. Okay. So it was very nice. And,
thank you, sir.
I'm very happy that very few people have been doing some programs on creativity. And I congratulate you for taking the initiative, because creativity is in our life in every moment into that. So it was really, I enjoyed it.
Yeah, thank you very much. And anyone else who would like to, you know, talk about, give a little feedback. Give
yes,
me one
ma'am.
Negative point for improvement also.
Yeah, yes, ma'am. It's really very wonderful program. I have been following up the webinars from you, design thinking, as well as this activity I got lately joined. And I felt really very interesting. It is like an, I can say, odd one out. It's like I felt like a design thinking quite really. These days we are completely missing thinking aspect, and that was the design thinking. And now it is one step ahead, thinking as a creative thinking, and again creativity again part of thinking. I felt really very interesting, and I'm very happy and looking forward for great learnings in the writing skills also, where I joined. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you so much. So great, and like you've been following quite a few webinars. That's really, you must have learned a lot from these, because yes. It's not just me. I am, every time we are actually calling at least one guest speaker who is going to speak on an expert topic. Like today we had Sagar. So next time we are going to have actually two guest speakers.
Okay, ma'am.
So, yeah, so I will continue with the creativity thing, but there will be two more speakers talking about how to use creativity in different contexts.
Thank you, ma'am. And also I would like to say thank you so much to Sagar, sir. It's really the way Sagar, sir, has been put the presentation very crisp and clear. It's really...
thank you, sir. Thank you.
Reached very well. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Glad I could help.
I thoroughly enjoyed Sagar's presentation, and it's not a brickbat, but I wish you could have used Royal Enfield as one of the old school examples when you were discussing the interesting topic. Because I don't know how Royal Enfield is the oldest motorcycling company in the world, and our motorcycle Bullet. Oldest motorcycle company in the world in continuous production. Even after the England plant shut, we were continuing to produce. And I must, and we all at Royal Enfield are very proud to say that we make and manufacture Royal Enfields in Chennai for the world. And we are really very proud of it. Thank you.
Totally. Thanks.
So yeah, I've put in one other link, that is a LinkedIn post where we posted. So if you can just give your feedback, if you don't want to give a detailed feedback, you can just drop in your comments and encourage us. These are all, we are conducting free webinars. We are doing it pro bono, at least for this year. So it's like a corona gift for everyone. So we would really love to get some encouragement from you. If you want us to keep going on, you can put in comments and you really let us know how you liked it. And if you have any suggestions for future topics. So next topic is going to be again on creativity on the 15th.
And post that, we are planning for multiple intelligence, which is another going that series is going to be a little longer because there are 9 intelligences and we are going to have 9 different sessions for these 9 intelligences. That's going to be an exhaustive webinar, and it's going to happen every Saturday from the next month. Any other suggestions? If you have any other topic you would want to learn about, please let me know. I can find experts for that, and I can, bring them on board to speak on that. Okay, so give me your detailed feedback on the document I shared, or you can just drop in your comment on LinkedIn. So we'll be very happy to receive your feedback. So it was really nice to have you all here, and I'll see you next on the 15th webinar. I hope everybody is going to be free on 15th as this is the Independence Day. So let us enjoy Independence Day with more creativity. Thank you so much for joining us. And thank you, Sagar, for taking time for conducting this session.
Thank you, Pooja. Thanks for the opportunity. Thanks so much.
Okay, see you all then. Bye.
All right. See you guys. Bye.
Bye.
All right. Bye-bye.